Good day, everyone out there. This is Debby Bruck from Homeopathy World Community, introducing you to Jayney Goddard and also Dr. Deepak Sharma today. It is September 10th, 2012, on the Health In Show. We're going to be talking about anti-aging, a popular subject, and we have with us Dr. Deepak Sharma from New Delhi, India, of the Orbitz Clinics, and he is a wonderful teacher, lecturer, and we're going to see anything that you are involved with it with anti-aging also, and welcoming Amnon Nissan of Nissan Communications, our producer, for working the set here and getting the sound and tuning into places all around the world. So I hope everybody is sending tweets out to their friends and letting them know that they can tune in at any time or listen to the archive after the show. Jayney Goddard, homeopath, hypnoanalytical psychotherapist, has unsurpassed knowledge of all types of complementary medicine and natural health care. She is recognized as one of the world's leading experts on complementary medicine and is the president of the Complementary Medical Association, the CMA, the world's largest professional membership body for complementary medicine. In addition, Jayney has a vast knowledge of the research base supporting complementary medicine and natural healthcare and has written and edited 3 encyclopedias on the subject, including Complementary Health, The Scientific Verdict on What Really Works for Collins, which involved Jayney scouring over 10,000 published studies, turning them into English, and arranging them in an extremely useful and accessible format. And we're really going to be I could go on and on about the accomplishments and the involvement in the community and the proactive work that she does talking about homeopathy. I'm so pleased and honored to be speaking with you today. You can wave hi.
Debbie, it's a huge honor. Yes. And when I received your invitation, I was absolutely overwhelmed. So thank you so much for having me. I feel very blessed to be here. Thank you.
You've accomplished so much in your lifetime, Dr. Deepak.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much, Debbie, and welcome, Jayney. And thank you so much for coming to the show. And we would like to hear about the complementary medicines and what are the effects. And everyone must know about the effects of the complement medicines on the every country and in the world.
Yes. Dr. Deepak, you are so young. Will this be helpful? This
Thank
information
you.
Be helpful to him? He's a young man.
Thank you.
Debbie, it's never too young to start, honestly. Okay. It's really interesting, you know, this whole anti-aging thing. First of all, can I be absolutely straight with you guys? Because I actually don't like the term anti-aging. The problem is it's one of those kind of umbrella terms that we have to use because everybody kind of knows what it means. The problem for me with the problem I have with that term is it implies, it's almost pejorative, it almost implies there's something wrong with aging. Well, of course, there's nothing wrong with getting older chronologically. I mean, that's happening to all of us. Nobody has a time machine, as far as I'm aware, that we could actually jump in and rewind the clock and end up back 10 years ago. It cannot be done, obviously. But what we can do is we can halt and even reverse the biomarkers of aging, thus reducing our predisposition towards certain types of largely avoidable chronic diseases. Now, that's where I'm coming from. And so when you know where I'm coming from with it, you can understand exactly why I want to do this. The reality in this day and age, of course, is that while we're seeing an aging population in the main, not in all countries, but in the main, we're seeing a population that is getting older. For example, in the UK and certainly in the US, the super centenarians are the fastest growing sector of the of society. So that kind of really gets, it makes you really, really stop, and it makes you pause for thought. Certainly the boomers, the baby boomers, so anybody who's sort of in their 60s, so anybody sort of say mid-40s to mid-60s and slightly older, they are really a very, very dramatically growing population as well. Now, the problem is that if those people don't stay well and look after themselves and reduce the drain on medical systems, because they're developing different types of chronic disease, then we're going to see a totally bankrupted society. We're in enough trouble as it is financially at the moment, as we all know. But the problem is when you add into the mix the amount of money it takes to care for somebody with, let's say, type 2 diabetes, or somebody who's stricken with arthropathies, or somebody who's suffering from a largely preventable type of cancer, that, you know, it just really does make you stop and think, you know, there's so much that can be done. And this is really where I'm coming from. On a very, very personal note, I myself have a very aggressive form of rheumatoid arthritis that I've been working with over the years. And I've actually managed to get that now totally into remission, having had really one of the most aggressive types that you can get. So it just does go to show that with lifestyle changes, with mind-body work, you can achieve absolutely miraculous stuff. Now, my passion is homeopathy. That was the first discipline I trained in. It will always be my first love. I then went on to subsequently do some postgraduate work in the psychoanalysis, hypnoanalysis field, because I wanted to be a better case taker. So for the audience listening, and I know a lot of you will be homeopaths, yes, I'm talking about this anti-aging stuff, but I'm looking at it from the really big picture. And that does include utilizing homeopathic remedies. It includes mind body work. It includes absolutely everything.
That's a lot that you've been working on. So there's two thoughts that come to mind. One is, superficially, women are targeted constantly, something to remove their wrinkles. Yeah. That's one thing that I think about. And it's a very superficial way of just on the surface appearance, as opposed to really going in below the skin into the well-being of all of our organs and keeping them clean and functioning well. And then the other concept that you said, that you've been working so many years in this area of healing, and you were motivated, you were self-motivated to investigate all of these different complementary medicines for yourself because you wanted to live a full life and a long life. And we also bring the word longevity into anti-aging.
Yes, Deb raised some really interesting points there. First of all, the superficiality of wrinkles and so on. I'll come onto that in just a moment. Longevity is such an important word because, as I said earlier, you know, we're seeing a society with an increasing lifespan. What we're seeing is a decreasing health span. So people are experiencing end of life ailments and chronic disease for a longer period of time. That means that they have more years of extreme disability. Now, I have kind of seen things really at first hand. 10, 11 years ago, I was so, so ill that I was in a hospital and I really wasn't expected to make it. At that stage. So I had those life skills available to me to appraise the situation and to bring in the experts that I needed to bring in because I wasn't able to do anything for myself. I was completely immobile. So, you know, it was this interesting learning process, a process for which I'm very intensely and very deeply grateful that I got to see it, but also, of course, that I survived. You know, my survival was totally down to, at that time, complementary medical approaches, integrated medicine, that kind of thing. So, yeah, I guess I see this from a slightly different perspective from just a mere academic process. So that's one thing. The second thing was the idea that Debbie, just to come back to your first point there, the point being that you were mentioning about the superficiality of wrinkles and so on. Yeah, I totally agree with you. You know, every single picture in every magazine pretty much is airbrushed. So I'm talking about women's magazines and so on. Okay, they are. And so what we're seeing that is we're supposed to be holding up to be the ideal is, I believe, it does not exist. So what to do? There's a beautiful saying. Oh, sorry. See, you're in telling me and out. Is this any better? Can you go?
Yeah, we're just asking you to bring your mic closer to your mouth.
Higher.
Let's
higher?
See. Okay, see how that goes.
Okay, fine. All right. It could be the connection. I live in paradise, but it's at the back of beyond. We have very little sort of technical.
Oh, you're out in the outback.
It's right. See it. It's absolutely glorious, but we've got a very slow connection, so I do apologize.
Okay.
The the superficiality of wrinkles and whatnot, Debbie. It is superficial. That beautiful saying, of course, you know, that wrinkles show where smiles have been. And I think that's absolute. Having said that, you know, we also have to the idea that there are some people out there who may wish to change how they look. They may feel very on the inside and feel that what's presented on the outside is not them. An awful lot when I talk to people about anti-aging, longevity, and so on. And, you know, there are realistic natural healthcare approaches that do improve your appearance. And I also believe that there is a psychological benefit in having high self-esteem. I think that that is a no-brainer, isn't it? So if you have high self-esteem, and that in many people links into the fact that they are feeling that they look as they want to look, is a tremendous mental, emotional, and physiological boon. So it does help, and there are rationales for actually maybe looking at the slightly more surface concerns that people have. Now, make dramatic changes to your appearance with a correct diet. You can make dramatic changes to your appearance with meditation. You know, there are all sorts of amazing solutions that our remit within complementary medicine. So I believe is that within complementary medicine, we stand head and shoulders above conventional medicine insofar as we have the ability to intelligently modulate the immune system. Now, a lot of problems that we're seeing, diabetes, the cardiovascular diseases, certain cancers, arthropathies, and so on, are very much linked into lifestyle, and we know that anyway as practitioners. However, what we can do is we can actually reverse those very, very easily in a very, very straightforward manner, given enough time. And that time is obviously, especially in certain cancers. So much that can be done. So do you have questions? Is there any burning desires to know anything else at the moment about this?
I have a comment from the chat, Kavitha Kukunor. Has written, thank you for introducing Jayney to all listeners as the topic is very interesting and important. And I want to know, if I may ask a personal question, you said that you were not in a very good state of being. What was it that you personally did? I mean, we are all working so hard and spending so much of our time out there in the community, going to work, taking care of kids, the family, the house that breaks down, all sorts of the car, you know, whatever it is. We have concerns and worries and daily pressures. What was it specifically to move you out of that place of paralysis?
Yes. Great. Thank you very much. Okay, where do I start? It's a kind of, I'll give you the short version because otherwise it's quite long. The short version is that I really used a gestalt. I think that there is no one single answer. I think that we're such complex, and those we need to honor that. And the idea that you take one thing and expect it to work is actually almost a nonsense. Now, I hark back to my training as a classical homeopath, and back in the day when I we. Very much educated in the respect that if the similimum, it is the one true remedy, and everything will fall into place. Yes, I'm sure that in Hahnemann's day that may have been true, but you know, people then weren't being exposed to the dramatic numbers of chemicals and pollutants and toxins that we are these days. So that you have to look at nutrition, you've got to look at mind-body work, you have to look at stress, you've got to look at whatever it is that works for you. Now, my particular passion within medicine is immune modulation. And what immune modulation is, it's rather different from somebody saying, oh, everybody, let's go and boost our immune systems. That implies a very poor understanding of the immune system and the incredible finesse with which it works. Once you understand within complementary medicine that we have this extraordinary set of tools available to us whereby we can actually upregulate and downregulate the expression of various different types of cytokines, and also, of course, within the field of epigenetics, we can switch on and switch off the different expressions of different types of genes that are associated with all sorts of different physiological phenomena. So, and we can do that with nutrition. So what to get myself out of the hospice? Well, it was a combination of following a vegan diet, which works for me. It may not be for everybody, but actually the evidence probably is the way to get most people out there. Do it intelligently, and you know what you take the time to actually educate yourself properly so that you know exactly what you should be doing for your health. You can't just jump onto a vegan diet, call yourself a vegan, eat donuts and popcorn, and that's it. You know, it isn't going to work. You're going to die very quickly. So what I do now is I follow a raw living vegan and I make sure I take the correct supplements. I do my Tai Chi, my Qi Kung, my Bensing, my Pilates. I'm always out there exercising. One of the most crucial things is socializing, spending time with your loved ones, with your friends. There's just so much that can be done. And it makes you happy. This is the beauty of it. It does make you happy. And it's just wonderful. And I have to say, it's the best thing that ever.
Okay, we have a little frozen moment here. So I was going to ask. Yeah, we're kind of losing your sound a little bit. I was going to ask about the raw foods diet because I had just been watching videos and reading up on all of these folks who are out there connecting with me on Twitter, Blythe Raw Alive. I mean, whoever is out there doing these shows. And another person has, a young man, has cured his diabetes and selling thousands of books. Simply, I mean, this is type 1 diabetes just with the raw foods diet and greens. And these are things that, I mean, it takes getting pushed to the end of your rope to make these life-changing decisions in order to, I want to, and also Kavitha down there in the chat wants to know, how do you do all the time management, accomplish your tasks, go to work, take care of the family, the house, and now you're going to be doing meditation and breathing and Qigong and all the beautiful things that I absolutely adore, but somebody's got to be taking care of everything else. Are we frozen still? Okay, maybe you've got to refresh. Okay, you're live.
Live, hey.
Okay.
Debbie, yes, it's a very, very good question. You know, something has to give, and it's all about giving up being perfect. And for me, that was a very, very hard one because I grew up, I was a ballet dancer.
Oh.
And the essence of having to be perfect, isn't it? You know, you have to have a perfect line, you have to have the perfect body. Yeah, exactly.
I was a perfect ballerina. I would be admiring you.
But anyway, so it was for me, it was about giving up perfection. So you know what? I'm not too bothered if my house is a mess. I'm not too bothered if the cat has to wait to be fed. She'll get fed eventually. It's one of those things whereby you've just got to be compassionate with yourself. And you've got to be compassionate with your loved ones. But key is, if you can be compassionate to yourself, that compassion ability springs from. So, what really starts happening is the time taken to meditate. You know, meditation, it only takes 20 minutes. What it's so easy. And I just stick on my iPad at night, just before I go to sleep, and just listen to a guided meditation. I've been doing the Deepak Chopra 21-day thing that he had up on his site recently. About that.
So is that free for everyone, the 21-day?
It was up free. I don't know if it's still there. If not, you can download it, and it's really like next to nothing. So it's
worth it.
Because integrate.
Okay.
Is that you've got a whole 21-day program, and you don't have to spend the time thinking, okay, now I meditate. It's simply a case of, oh, yes, I'm going to do that thing that I've been doing. And, you know, they say it takes 21 days to create a habit. Well, it's true. And they've created this 21-day system. And there's some beautiful, beautiful meditations on there, and it really does work. So I'm enjoying that tremendously. To everybody, stop being so blinking hard on yourselves. I think life is enough, you know, and we really just need to be a little gentle with ourselves. That would be my message to take away.
It's a lot of self-talk, and I wanted to thank Victor, who has provided meditation on the website Homeopathy World Community. Just go to the videos there, and we've got plenty of meditations. Besides news and learning about alternative medicine, complementary and homeopathy, there are many resources that are out there that you don't have to spend money. But if you want to stick with Deepak Chopra, that's great too. He's a real a leader in the field for us. So what else? Dr. Deepak, did you have something? He's frozen too. We're frozen in time, so we can breathe. It's always good to breathe. You know, I think it's a conscious effort that when you notice you're feeling what your body is feeling and going into the sensations of the body, that's when you can take note and let down that the stress that you're holding. And you can do that anytime, any moment. So a meditation can happen anywhere, anytime for you.
Yes, you're absolutely right. As can Pilates. It's interesting how, you know, again, talking about time management and how, you know, you can integrate, for example, a Pilates exercise while you're standing in the grocery store waiting to pay for your groceries. You know, it's all about being aware of what benefits you and how you can maximize and integrate that into your life. Now, just going back to the whole anti-aging thing, I actually went to a place in the States called the Hippocrates Health Institute. And this is where I learned how to become a raw living vegan. I went on their 21-day life change program. And there are people that do these things as well. It just so happened that I live in Florida part of the year, and it was easy for me to go to. Anyway,
it's in Florida? Florida, USA?
That's right, yes.
Okay.
In West Beach. And, but outside of Florida, but it was still easy enough for me to get there. Now, the interesting thing about that was that I had my biomarkers tested, and I was coming in at my chronological age, because I was at that time very, very sick, obviously. But within 3 weeks, I had reversed my aging measurements by 28 years in a 3-week period. So it just goes to show that we can do the most extraordinary things within a very short space of time if we are but willing to make the effort and to make the changes necessary. It moves us out of the zone, but goodness, it really does. A lot of stuff can happen. A lot of shift can happen very, very quickly.
So do you take these numbers to heart, things that you read about the labs, the science? I mean, how much of it really impresses you? Or is that some kind of a biofeedback to you to say, wow, I'm really doing great? I mean, how do you think about that?
Great question. Love that. That's a very, very good point. I think that there are certain overall things that you can look at, certain measurements that you can look at that are accepted as pretty good estimates of kind of where you're at age-wise, biologically. Okay, not chronologically, biologically. And one of the most modern forms of age, if you like, biological age management is telomere length testing. Now, incredibly expensive at the moment. Is done, and I'm not sure if I really want to, but I'm just happy to feel great, so that's fine. But you can actually have the telomeres, those little tiny bits on the end of your chromosomes that almost stop them from unraveling, a bit like shoelaces, you know, the plastic on the ends of shoelaces that stops from unraveling. As the cell divides, what happens is those telomeres get shorter and shorter and shorter. So by work out which are your shortest telomeres, it kind of gives a very good overview of your biological age. Now, what just in telomere length is that people who are under a great deal of stress have shorter telomeres, therefore they have actually a shorter predicted lifespan. The good news is that those telomeres can actually be regrown, and one of the effective ways of regrowing your telomeres is and generally speaking, mindfulness meditation, if we're going to say, you know, which type. There's a lot of work that can be done, and it's free and it's easy. So I wouldn't necessarily say everybody go and get your telomeres measured, because I don't think it's necessary. But you need to be able to monitor yourself, I think, and check in with yourself and see how good you're feeling. And if you can do that and work out how adjustments that you need to make in order to be optimally healthy, then I think that's absolutely key. So you drink your green smoothies, drink your green juices, have your wheatgrass, move yourself towards a plant-based diet. It really is absolutely key.
Eating a plant-based diet is good for you and the planet, and there's plenty of news about that. What about bioidentical hormones? That is something that is sweeping the nation. What do you think about that?
In America, we don't really have this so much in the UK. My concern is that if you are going to utilize bioidentical hormones, my concern is you've really got to work with somebody and work closely with them on an ongoing basis so that you can get yourself measured fairly constantly. I don't think enough measured, take a tablets and then maybe go back a year or so later. I don't think that's going to work for anybody, because we are particularly women, when we become sort of perimenopausal, menopausal, we're in a constant flux with hormones going all over the place, as everybody knows. It's a case of, yes, thank you very much, I'll go and take this prescription, as they did with HRT, for example, which was horrific. If we could really create a bioidentical hormone system, a structure, I don't know that it's a problem. But I've yet to see it really work properly, if that makes sense. What are your thoughts?
My thoughts are that using these other modalities that you have mentioned, feeling happy itself, feeling satisfied and fulfilled in your life and what you're doing, who you're with, the socialization factor, finding loving family and friends, being able to feel that you have been heard and communicating well, being able to move your body, thinking, your brain function is very important, especially as we age. Taking care of all of these things, despite the fact that we are being, by our environment, there's so much toxic stuff out there, in food, in our air, water, in our land, the way our products are grown. I mean, these are things that concern me. And if we can somehow, I want to say, let all of that go and find peace within, I think that all of those telomere markers, I'm just imagining in my mind doing a mental feedback of those numbers without going in for a clinical exam, strengthening our bones through exercise, just all of the good things that we know about, if we utilize the simple ways of life, I think that's, I don't, I'm not one that would go in for manipulating hormones or any of the other things that are out there. I'm really at a base level.
The problem is the pollution is everywhere. Pollution in the mind, pollution in the air, pollution in the milk, pollution in the food. And I had the data regarding the oxytocin-induced milk. The oxytocin-induced milk is always causes a liver damage and causes a jaundice, and that is increased bilirubinemia in the blood. So everything is polluted. In this polluted world, you can save our mind only. And there is some data on the net is available. And basically, the biogenetically modified food always causes the anxiety in the mind, always causes the irritability in the mind, and there are so many factors which may include the pollution.
Yes, I completely agree. Actually trying to figure out where to get your food from is really difficult. Has it been irradiated? Mm. It's very interesting. It's interesting also that you mentioned the ewe's milk. That is really intriguing, Dr. Deepak. So, I think that we've just got to be very aware and try our best, without stressing out too much yes. about it. It's really key that we're not stressing ourselves, because there's an awful lot of guilt, I think, particularly having to feed their kids and worrying so desperately about, am I being perfect? Am I doing this right? And I think, yes, just taking a little bit of time to be kinder to yourself and to know that you're doing the best you can, that's really important. So it's like I'm running a conference on the 9th of November. It's called Young Day, which is a nod to the idea that we are daily doing little things actually improve our health and well-being on all levels, mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual. And so it's have a lot of speakers from all over the world who are coming in who have expertise in disparate fields, but it all comes together so beautifully and so holistically. And I'm really excited about that because I hope it's possible and members of the public, because I really want people to grasp the idea that they can be empowered and they can make the choices, and that these things that we can do, these baby steps that we can take, are available to absolutely everybody. So somebody can't go out and if they can't afford organic food, because not everybody can, and I'm well aware of, they can still breathe, they can still do type. Still spend time with friends. Joy is such an important thing. Laughter is one of the most anti-aging, rejuvenating things you can possibly do.
I'm sorry, I missed that last part about the laughter.
I was just saying that, laughter is one of the most important rejuvenation techniques that's available to us. And I was just saying, one of the best classes I ever went to in my life was a laughter yoga class.
Yes, they do have them going out all over the place, and I'm sure you can find one in your region, your neighborhood, that you could attend. I don't hear.
Go to in your neighborhood. You can actually do them online as well.
Oh, good idea.
Free groups, and they are hilarious. And you feel, and you know what, afterwards you feel like you've done the best workout ever, and you feel happy.
Right. Well, I think also, I'm out there on the social networks constantly, and I receive a tremendous amount of not only news and information, making friendships, reading motivational, inspirational quotes constantly. And this morning, if I could find, here's the one that I saw this morning. I read it to Amnon. Somebody, I don't even know who it is, wrote, the last three times I've eaten at blank pizza parlor, I won't give the name, I've thrown up. If I keep this up, I'm going to look amazing. And this was, you know, something humorous. I retweeted it. So get out there and share the laughter. Share what you think hits your funny bone. Bring smile and joy to other people. The more that you give, the more that you will receive. And I think just underlying the great sages and the quotes of wisdom that we read, you know, those are the things that if we take that to heart, we're going to improve our longevity, our lives, and create joy within each of ourselves. And that's going to reverberate and resonate out there.
I completely agree, Debbie. You know, I mean, I think that one of the problems is that in this, in the societies that we live in, I think one of the problems is that we forget that we are these divine, joyous human beings who should be capable of immense passion and love, fulfillment, and it's so often just go aside. And I think it really has come time to turn off the television, stop being by the negativity and the toxicity of what's out there in the media, stop reading the newspapers. I mean, really, it's almost a necessity to actually slightly cut yourself somehow, because, you know, the media that we are spoon-fed is by nature in order, it has a financial imperative. And therefore, it has to be sensational. It has to be negative. You know, negativity sells newspapers. So, you know, negativity sells the news. I have to say, there's been this incredible sea change here in the UK because of the Olympics that has closed yesterday. You know, they just finished the Paralympics finals yesterday. Parade going on right at the moment through London with all the Olympic and the Paralympic athletes who won medals. Sea change has happened and throughout the rest of the UK, it's palpable. You know, there's this incredible, overwhelming sense of positivity. Hope that continues. It may well do. You know, we have to hope because it has dramatically changed people. And I think this is just so important for societies and for all of us.
It's really based on hopefulness and thinking that you have a positive, better future to look forward to. And, of course, we don't usually get that message. And it starts with self and then transfers to friends and the people you interact with and then grows to the larger society. So it's a feedback loop. But yes, you have to be the person to do the feeding. You're feeding greens, you're feeding smiles, you're feeding, you know, tell somebody how gorgeous they are. And I find as I get, I mean, it's always been true, but as I get older, when you look at somebody and see the beauty within them, they are gorgeous on the outside, no matter, you know, anything else. They look so beautiful in your eyes, just by thinking of the goodness in them.
Yes. I completely agree. I really, really do.
Yes.
And it's
For that thing, I always say to everyone that think healthy.
Think healthy.
If you think healthy, then think healthy. If you think healthy, you will definitely get everything in health. So
yes,
think healthy.
The correct attitude is absolutely crucial, isn't it? Don't you think?
Absolutely.
Yes, yes, it really, truly is. It's very interesting, actually. One of the studies that impressed me so much recently on anti-aging and longevity and biomarker age reversal and so on, really just sociability and how many years an active social life can add to your health, can add to your lifespan, your health span. Socialization is incredibly important. Sexuality, healthy expression of your sexuality is also absolutely key. Being in a healthy, supportive relationship is also absolutely key. But it all comes back down to, we don't know what the actual particular parts are. You know, for example, a healthy sex life, is it the fact that you're having sex and you're being active? Or is it the fact that you're in deep
profound relation with another person. You know, we can't really tease out, nobody can actually do that study, tease out which is which. It would be difficult to get that one past an ethnicity, obviously. But it's this whole issue of socialization that actually is one of the most important things. So you're quite right, Debbie, smiling at somebody. It costs nothing to smile, does it? And you could just make somebody's day, just reaching out and touching them like that.
Right. On the other hand, melancholy and depression is probably the worst thing for a human being to experience. It's very, very painful. People say it's more painful than physical pain. And it also depresses everything in the body. It slows functioning, and it's not cleansing. And it's destructive. It's self-destructive to feel this way. And if there's any hints or clues or anything that you can say about how to get out, that means people who get into this mode, they sink lower and lower, and it's potentially something externally, internally, how it affects them, their self-esteem, as you said. What, any little trick or hint or something that can move a person out?
Debbie, this is such a good question. Thank you. I'm getting all excited because this is part and parcel of where I really spend a lot of time with my work. Depression is a fascinating subject. It is, as you say, it is extraordinarily painful and actually physically dangerous. It is life-threatening. We all know that. What we discovered recently is that there is a link between chronic inflammation and depression. So we thought, for example, with rheumatoid arthritis, present to their doctors saying, "Doctor, I feel depressed." It was always that the doctor's response would be, "Well, that's because you're in pain. Of course you're feeling depressed and you're disabled and you can't live your life as you used to." So it's always assumed that this exogenous depression. However, what's now been discovered is that inflammation has a direct link with depression. It actually seems that there is an endogenous cause. So also see the same thing in diabetes, but 1 and 2, the people with diabetes are more likely to be depressed. Now, if you think about the physiology, what's actually going on in diabetes, you think about elevated blood sugar levels, and you think about the instance of chronic inflammation that those people are actually experiencing. So again, you see, so it's this whole vicious circle. So of course, you know, somebody with a chronic disease is usually an underlying inflammatory component to a disease. And a component that links in and can produce in many, many people depression to a greater or lesser extent. So
is it the chicken or the egg?
In point, how do we stop? We have to jump in to this vicious circle, and we've got to somehow put the brakes on somewhere. And it actually, in my mind, doesn't matter quite where we jump. We have to do that. And the point, so the point is, what can we do? What are the things that we can jump?
I'm sorry, please repeat. We're losing sound a little bit. Can you repeat that? What do we do to put the brakes on depression?
You've got to jump this loop. It doesn't matter where you are. You've just got to do something. Don't do anything.
Movement? Do movement? Is that what you're saying?
And or meditation, and or breathing, and or socialization, and or sexuality, and a pet. You know, any of these things that are life-affirming enable you to start the cascade effect to then add other things into the mix. Now, the problem is, I'm realistic. I know that if I'm dealing with a patient who has telling them start living food, diet, is ridiculous because that it so much psychological where implement that, and even what to make a I
I'm sorry. Okay, somehow we're kind of we're fading out a little bit, so we're missing. Let me review what you said and what I heard, just so that you know where I'm at. So it's all about communication and encoding messages to each other. And what I want to say is that you said probably that for each individual person, there has got to be a touchstone, something that's going to move them from depression, from illness, disease, inflammation. And that for each person could be something different, whether it is sitting in the sunshine, going for a walk, meditation, doing qigong, slow-moving exercises, deep breathing. So you've given a gamut of choices for each person. And we just have to find which one of those things is going to move that person in the correct direction, rather than give them an ultimatum or a program, say, okay, start doing your greens. I mean, a person's not going to be able to do that unless it touches their heart in some way. Let me know if this is what, that's as much as I heard. And then you were going into something else. I need some ginkgo.
That's funny. Okay. Don't we all? I think you've summed it up really well there, Debbie. Yes, I think that it's kind of, what can we do to empower our patients?
Okay.
That's really, and so it's really a case of working with them. This one, love the work, the postgraduate work that I did, hypnoanalysis, because I come out of this Ericksonian school of work, and it's a very elegant way of being able to cut through the noise, psychological noise, to actually drill down into individuals' psychological pain, if you like, out what it is that makes that person tick, to really get to a clear understanding of what triggers you might be able to support them with that would then be able to grasp and run with. And the thing is, once you do that, once you give somebody something they can run with, you've then empowered them. And then when you have empowerment in depression, that starts to chug and make all of those little changes that need to be made. And you know, these little crazy changes can be silly little things like getting somebody to brush teeth with the non-dominant hand, for example. Little things that are just about stepping outside your normal day-to-day and just doing something, no matter what it is, slightly different. So whether it's putting, you know, your left shoe on first instead of your right on, or putting your jeans on with your left first and then your right leg, you know, just shifting it up, moving a little bit of fun with it. But getting somebody, for example, as I say, to brush their teeth with a non-dominant hand empowers them, because you're showing them that they can be mindful and they can actually start to take control of things. It's amazing how quickly this cascade actually starts to manifest itself. And I've seen it time and time and time again. And what really my aim in doing this is to move the person to a place where they can go onto this plant-based anti-inflammatory diet, where they can integrate meditations, which are also inflammatory, visualizations, which are anti-inflammatory. Once we can do that, we're kind of stopping that vicious circle, because we're not actually then producing those pro-inflammatory cytokines.
Beautiful. It sounds to me that what you're helping a person do is take control of their life. That they have perhaps lost control, and that is self-empowerment, learning that they can be independent. But a key component is partnering, being able to ask for help and accept help from somebody else. That is a really big thing for many, many people, to be able to receive that.
Yes, it's extremely difficult. Yes, I think as homeopaths, sometimes we need to be a little bit more accessible. Now, I know that we're all trained in different ways, but I was trained in such a way that it was undesirable to be
accessible to your patient, that you would have very, very strict boundaries. I do believe in strict boundaries, of course, but there was always this, you know, thou shalt not phone the patient, thou shalt only expect the patient to phone you, and you would never go and see a patient, and so on. Very, very Hanumanian, very, very classical. You know, that was a few years ago. I'm sure that trainings have changed. You know, but I think as grasping the idea that we can be a compassionate partner in a healing process, we know where our boundaries are and how to set those boundaries and how to maintain them, I think that we can work absolute wonders. I also think it's important as well to think back, again, homeopathy, because of the true wonders that happen mentally, physically, emotionally, spiritually, when we do give the right remedies. You know, that be that bit, that little nudge that that person needs in order to actually then be able to integrate all of the other bits that they have. Let's not throw homeopathy, you know, the baby out with the bathwater, because, you know, it is the most extraordinarily powerful medical system. And we're blessed that we have this system available to us.
It goes very deeply. And it's a partnership between the homeopath and the patient, the homeopath and the client, that there is that conversation going and progress being made that's always being reviewed.
Absolutely. I don't know this, but you know, very often the first time somebody's case is taken, it's very often the first time ever truly been heard. That's even the similimum and getting the right and so on. That hearing, that being heardness, is intrinsic to a person's healing.
Yeah, this hour has gone really by quite quickly. I want people to know where they can contact you about. You said that there's going to be an expo or a conference or something that you're involved with. A little bit more about that. I also have on Homeopathy World Community, the page with the announcement for today's show has a list of books that you have written on the subject, plus a little video there. So you've got measles, mumps, chickenpox, and whooping cough, which is supposedly at epidemic levels now. So that's something people can read that you've written. Coughs and the family, homeopathy, and you. So you have many resources. So go ahead and tell us how we can connect with you and about your conference.
I was going to say, those aren't my books. They may be somebody else's, so I don't know. But
they have your last name. I'm sorry. So whoever it is, it's a J. Goddard.
Ooh, I have a doppelganger. Cool.
Maybe you have a long-lost relative out there.
I do, yes, that's interesting. My books are more encyclopedias and also...
We need to check out your encyclopedias then.
And also on immunology, utilizing different types of complementary medicine, including... and immune modulation is really one of my big things, as you've probably gathered. Yes, the conference. What do you do, Debbie? It's on the 9th of November. So anybody who's either in the UK or can get to the UK then, what I'd like to do would be to set up a special code for all of the HWC sites so that they could actually get a free ticket to enter. It's normally £90, which is about, $120, $150. But I would actually like to give free tickets to the HWC community.
Oh, I feel like we're on Oprah. Cool. Okay, so we need people to respond to us to either get in the chat and say you want one, or on Twitter, I'm there. I will post links on Facebook. I'm there. Janie's there. Dr. Deepak is there. So, yeah, give us some feedback and you'll get a ticket.
Excellent. Yes. I'll set up a special. Yes. Then we can get going with that one, Debbie.
Okay. So is the best way to contact you through Facebook?
Yes, you can contact me through Facebook or... Twitter feed, or just drop me. In fact, actually, I'm quite happy to give you my email address. If people have questions, if they want to email me, I'm more than happy to take questions.
Okay. Well, we'll probably go ahead, Dr. Deepak.
Yes, and I would like to thank you, Jayney, for such a nice thing and to hear about the natural things. And I'm happy to see the long hairs and the results of the natural laws and the natural ingredients she is taking. So thank you so much.
And she's a living example of what can be done. And if we,
I
wish I had her hair. Oh my gosh. Okay, we have a frozen screen. There you are.
All right.
Oh, that's good.
It's been so.
Okay, I think we're going. I think we'll end with Kavitha's proverb that she wrote on the chat. If you lose wealth, nothing is lost. If you lose health, something is lost. But if you lose character, everything is lost. So positive attitude plays great role in life. Thank you, Kavitha, for tuning in and sharing your knowledge. Thank you, Dr. Deepak, for spending time with us. And also, Jayney Goddard. We will have more feedback, and maybe you'll be on the show again in the future.
Okay, Debbie, thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much, Dr. Deepak, also. Bye-bye.
Okay,
talk soon.
Sending
bye-bye.
All of our love out there, waves of awareness. Until next time, bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye. You are tuned to the Nissan Communications Network. Our weekly lineup of call-in programs includes Computers 2K Now, with Amnon Nissan, Sundays 9 a.m. to noon. Health In with Debby Bruck, Mondays 11 a.m. to noon. The Scope of Things with Marilyn Shannon, Mondays 7 to 8 p.m. Breaking Free with Marilyn Shannon, Mondays 8 to 9 p.m. Body Talk with Cindy Prince, first Tuesdays 8 to 9 p.m. Reawaken Your Brilliance with Julie Seibert, Wednesdays 8 to 9 p.m. And if you tuned in too late, you can always watch each program in its entirety or download an MP3 audio file of it at www.nissancommunications.com. Sponsored by thatvidblasterguy.com, carolinaapparel.com, and deltaforce.net.